two calls, every stakeholder, the PowerPoints and now video of all the power, all the stakeholder calls will be archived on our website, the CFJJ/COVID-19-JJ website. And for those of you on who have RSVP'd and given me your email address, I will follow up in the next few days with a link to this PowerPoint. So the agenda for today, breaking up into five parts. The first part is we're going to be talking about the state of COVID-19 in Massachusetts, just what are the data in Massachusetts and the different agencies. Part two will be a parent's perspective, like all these numbers, who are the lives behind these numbers. Then we're going to go, part three is going to be our traditional summary of different state actions. We'll be looking at the juvenile courts, Department of Youth Services, probation, children and families. And then we have a panel from CPCS who can talk about their perspective as attorneys representing kids with involvement in all these agencies. And then after that is where we're going to have our first formal comment and question break before moving on to the next section. The second half of today's call, we're going to be talking about state advocacy efforts and ways you can get involved. And we're going to end with legal actions around a federal lawsuit and an update on the SJC cases. And then we will end with, and this will be the end where we have the question and comment area time for the end of the call. So with that, I want to just start with the state of the state of COVID in Massachusetts. So this is a breakdown of the data by number, by age. As you'll see, young people continue to be under, they're a smaller proportion, maybe because of testing or lack of testing or symptomatic, unsure. But right now, it's what we've seen as far. The impact is as you get older, it's a greater prevalence. We also want to make sure that you know that COVID-19 does not discriminate. We are going to be seeing, and now that everybody's talking about how in Massachusetts worst hit communities, they're mostly Black and Latino majority communities. So one of the things that are common among those cities, which I will show you in the next slide, is that they have the lowest average income in Massachusetts. They also, based on census data, have the highest density of like the number of people living in households, and a disproportionate number of them are essential workers. And it's not because essential it's a high rate of poverty. It's more like a lot of these essential workers are not getting a living wage. They are risking their lives to make sure that, you know, with the economy that we is trickling but still continues, is really on the backs of our essential workers who put their lives at risk. In so looking at the most recent data that came out, LC continues to be highest per capita rate of people with COVID positives. And then the next are Brockton, Everett, Lynn, Lawrence, and Revere. Boston has the highest number of people with testing positive for COVID, but it ranks 18th in the state per capita. And this was an analysis that was released by the Mass Public Health Association last month, that when we look at the racial inequities, we are seeing that Hispanics and Latino people are three times as likely as white people to be infected with COVID or testing positive for COVID. And Black and African-American individuals are more than two and a half times that of white people with COVID diagnoses. The second thing I wanted to talk about was, again, looking at who our population is, people who are in legal systems. So one of the things that is moving is, as you all know, the fact that young people who are in incarceration are at a higher risk of exposure and contracting COVID because of the nature of incarceration. There's because of a state lawsuit against DOC and the trial courts and basically the entire adult criminal justice system, there has been a movement to reduce the number of people who are incarcerated. So this is data based on the weekly reports that are going to the SJC. Over the past month, there's been a little over 300 people who have been 300 to 400 people who have been have been exiting the Department of Corrections incarceration, and for those in county houses of correction, that number is a little somewhat over 1,000, like around 1,300 people have been released. The vast majority of those are those who are held in pretrial detention. It also includes people whose sentences ended. The most significant, this is not broken down by county, because that was just too much information. But I know Middlesex County has had a 25% reduction in their census since middle of March. This only starts at the beginning of April because of the SJC reporting requirements. In terms of COVID prevalence in correctional institutions, so this is, again, based on data that is coming out of the SJC, that's required out of the SJC to be reported to the SJC. And anything prior to April 5th or April 6th is based on news reporting. So if you see and one of the things we wanted to highlight is the number of how people are being tested, and this is not by age, people who are tested who are incarcerated in DOC, as well as correctional staff, and the rate of COVID confirmed COVID positive. And in terms, and similarly for houses of correction, this is the rate of folks who are being tested, and the number of folks who are testing positive. Just wanted to highlight that in comparison to Department of Corrections and House of Corrections, the population between House of Corrections and Department of Corrections, if I go a little earlier, right now it's about 6,000 in House of Corrections and 7,600 in Department of Corrections, but the rate of testing is much lower, where in the Department of Corrections testing is it's almost 3,000, where Department of Corrections is barely hitting 450 of testing of incarcerated individuals. So that's one of the takeaways from this. The other piece of youth in Department of Youth Services, just to clarify, Department of Youth Services, because of their model, is it's a health and human services agency. It is based on a treatment model which has various treatment modalities. So unlike the adult correctional system, where you're either incarcerated and the most in a community-based setting is like a halfway house, or you're going to go home, Department of Youth Services has a variety of placement settings where some of them are secure, some of them are in the community. So for those that are in the blue range, so the bottom ones, there are of the number of people who are detained in a secure facility, who are committed, who are sentenced to custody of DYS, those are the blue portions. There's been, some movement around keeping young people out of locked facilities, but there's also been an increase in the young people who are supervised, so those who are committed to DYS, but serving that time of commitment in their community, whether in a group home or at their own homes or independent living. There's also a significant number of people, almost half of the people who are in the community are aged out of DYS voluntary services. So you see like a big chunk, a little over half of the young people who are served by or supervised by DYS are in the community. And this is all done, this information has been available since middle of March and has been publicly available and not part of the SJC case because of data that DYS has been sharing. And then in terms of the number of young people who are, the prevalence of COVID in DYS, these numbers are more frequent. They're not daily as in the adult system. But as you'll see, the number of young people with COVID is hovering at 15 right now statewide. 9 of them are in Suffolk County, 5 are in Worcester County, and the most recent one was 1 young person in Essex County. The rate of staff contracting COVID is much higher and at a higher climb. Just wanted to just mention about the testing protocol, because that was one of the things we're asking. I know in other states where there's been an outbreak of COVID, once they do wholesale testing of young people, they find that there was way more young people who are testing positive to COVID than those who are symptomatic. So when we asked DYS, are you planning to do any wholesale testing? The answer is there is no plans for wholesale testing. There is an option. I believe Fallon is a contractor that can come out and provide testing for staff and youth in facility, but right now they're relying on DPH guidance and the guidance of the medical directors of the contracted healthcare providers. So those are like Children's Hospital, UMass Medical, as well as DYS's own healthcare staff. What they do is they have a protocols around quarantine and medical isolation. So for those who are new intakes, they have a 14-day quarantine before coming into the general the program they'll be placed in. Not all youth serve 14 days, especially if they are detained, depending if they basically get released before the 14 days are over. There's also quarantines for folks, for young people who have been in close contact with anyone who has tested positive, whether it's a young person or staff. So in those cases, those young people are in quarantine as well. And what they do is when there is a positive test, they review the video feeds as well as having the interviews with folks to identify close contacts. And anybody who has been in close contact with someone who's in quarantine who has tested positive is also placed in quarantine. One really important distinction to recognize when we look at the national coverage of how COVID spreads in youth facilities in other states, the way DYS is set up in the secure facilities, it's a small number of people. So it may be one big building or in a home, but when it's a big building, the programs are really self-contained programs with a small number of young people. So it's not an entire facility gets locked down. It's really the young people in that locked unit who are in sort of their own, in that unit where they're together, where the testing and the contact tracing and the testing happen and the quarantines. So typically what happens is if a child is symptomatic or has been in close contact, they go into quarantine. They can, you know, they spend a lot of their time in their room, but if they go out, they have a mask. Sometimes an entire program is quarantined. So imagine like youth are in a program and one of them tests positive and the six youth are in quarantine. So I'm just giving an example. So in that case, it's much more free flowing. There has been a case where only one child has been in quarantine. So that young person would spend his day in his room rather than in common areas. One important thing that DYS continues to stress is any policies around quarantine and medical isolation do not supersede other policies, specifically the suicide risk. So if there is a suicide risk, they do modify the quarantine and isolation protocol so that they don't close doors. There's staff observation at all times to make sure young people are safe. And with that, I'm going to jump to introduce Mary Viano, the Associate Director of Parent Professional Advocacy League, who are going to talk to us about the work that they are doing with parents of young people who are, many of them with system involvement, to give the lives behind those numbers. Mary?
Great. Thank you so much, Sana, for having us. So I am the Associate Director for PAL, which is the Parent Professional Advocacy League. We are a statewide organization that supports children with levels of emotional, behavioral, mental health needs. One of the things that, just for people that are on the call that may not know PAL, PAL really is the lived experience behind the people that Sana had mentioned. So I'm a parent of three young adults and have raised them through either interagency involvement, and I often say have touched the juvenile justice world as well. So it's really important for us to work together in policies and kind of the next steps. I do want to highlight a few things that we're seeing and what PAL is recognizing. From PAL's perspective, and I think personally from my perspective, we have been very happy, satisfied, and quite frankly, excited with the communication that Commissioner Forbes from the Department of Youth Services has given us in making sure that parents are informed with what's going on regarding COVID. I think that just as you've shown, Sana, the data that has been available from the department, it really has been a true partnership that we've been able to see. But I also think that with the public health crisis, what we are seeing is just kind of this unknown for families. So a few of the pieces that we've seen directly is that we know that overnight arrests or arrests have been going down. And I think for many different reasons of what's going on in the community, but we are very concerned that if those arrests go up, kind of what would be the next step because of the courts being closed. And we know that they can see people virtually, but I think that it is something that as families, we're very concerned about in what does that mean for families impacted or young people impacted. PAL has also been working hard for youth that have gone back into the community and trying to figure out what the supports are that there. And I just wanted to kind of make two really important shout outs from what we're seeing. One, we did a publication called The Impact of Family Peer Support for Justice-Involved Families. I'm going to make sure that the link is there. I had sent it to Sana, but I can send it out also to the group. And a few of the highlights that came up with that is that if parents actually knew other parents and they received peer support, they were more effective in supporting families. And we really want to be able to look at that kind of across the point to get families to actually meet other people. So PAL is available for that. The second thing is really kind of the inequality that families experience. And it's really interesting because I think that as we've done this, and typically in juvenile justice, racial disparities has been talked about often. We have noticed across all state agencies that the inequity experience of families of color, especially families that identify as African American or Black, Black and Brown, really are not getting their needs met, whether it be special education, some of the protections that are there, the remote learning also has been a bit of a challenge as well. And the last thing that really it kind of focused on is that the majority of the children that we had seen, though there is a school impact, there's also an impact of what the families are able to support within the communities. And that kind of leads me to my next point on telehealth. So COVID arrives, it's a public health crisis, and things really shift, right? So we've talked about and we've done great things within the Commonwealth regarding the ability to really present out of the box and creative opportunities for families. But one of the impact that really hit with COVID is that telehealth hit here, and there's really an impact for families. So our first survey that went out, just quick poll on Facebook, telehealth had shown that 79% of the families said that yes, it did work, and 21% of the families had said no, there were several problems. We weren't really sure what those several problems were, so we wanted to actually be able to have more of a conversation and to figure out directly what it was. So PAL has just put out another survey, and this is a 20-question survey that only takes about 2 minutes, but here's what we're seeing. Youth that are re-entering into the community and or youth that are in the community right now, the experience of what they have with telehealth is very different. If you do not have a carrier that holds the platform of the clinical services or the supportive services, it's not working. For another component of telehealth challenges we're seeing is we have people, I'll just give an example. We had a mother that was walking to try to call someone on telehealth for psychiatry, and she had to walk to a library to get good internet connection. It didn't show confidentiality of what that family needed. So telehealth, though, we agree that there's a really good spot for this to be able to push out. I really want to reflect on kind of the conversation for today. When we do see youth going back into the community, into families, we really want to make sure that there's safety plans, there's crisis plans, because everything has shifted and changed. So for a snapshot, mobile crisis right now, the majority of them are doing mobile crisis assessments telehealth, and the ERs obviously are backed up. We do not want to involve police in going to homes if there's challenges, so we're trying to really keep a close eye on that as well. So any families that you have, we're doing it both for parents and youth. It closes the end of the month, but we would love to hear the perspective from families, really what's kind of the pieces that they're directly impacted by. And I'm just really thankful to be here. Thank you, Sana.
Thank you, Mary. So I know that the PowerPoint has the links to the report and to the two surveys. I also put them on the chat if that's easier for you to copy and paste. So next, we're going to go on the official actions of state agencies. And just so that you know, the information we're presenting is based on not just a official documents and guidance that has come up from these agencies, but we have been meeting with the commissioners, the chiefs, just to hear directly from them, give us the context. So we're going to be starting out with the juvenile court and the impact of what their actions are on young people. So I want to introduce Leon Smith, CFJJ's executive director, to start us on that conversation.
Thank you, Senna. Good afternoon, everyone. So in looking at first the court's responses under COVID, we need to look at two juvenile court standing orders that have come out recently. The first of those, Juvenile Court Standing Order 520, was initially issued on April the 6th, and it took the protocol that was set forth in the SJC case of CPCS and McDowell versus the Chief Justice of the court and applied that framework into juvenile court. The key tenet of this decision was it created a rebuttable presumption of release for young people who were detained on a pretrial level or due to a violation of probation. Now quickly, what does it mean to have a rebuttable presumption? It means that you should be released on your own recognizance or your own promise to appear in court at future hearings, unless it is established by a preponderance of evidence that your release would result in an unreasonable danger to the community or create a very high risk of flight. So it really tips the scales heavily in favor of a young person who is seeking release in this circumstance. This rebuttable presumption, young people are entitled to it unless they're detained under the dangerousness statute 58A or they're charged with a number of violent or serious offenses that are listed in the SJC case. These are the type, for an example, these cases include serious sexual offenses or cases like armed robbery that in the adult system would be subject to superior court jurisdiction. Now, if you're a young person and you are charged under 58A or under those serious or violent offenses, you still can come forward and make a motion to the court for release. You simply don't enjoy that same favorable presumption of release. So again, in that SJC case initially, DYS, you know, wasn't a party, juveniles weren't named, but juveniles and young people still are entitled to that beneficial framework through this standing order. One other piece of it, so that's for young people who are held on a pretrial level. For young people who are adjudicated, there are a couple of limited options that they do have. So a young person and their attorney can file a motion to revise and revoke the sentence. It's just as long as it falls within the 60-day deadline of Rule 29 of the Mass Rules of Criminal Procedure. Additionally, they can also file a motion to stay the execution of a sentence. So you see, there's a lot of options on the pretrial level. There are a couple of options. And again, these are simply options, legal options through the court. We'll talk about DYS a little later in the presentation and their grant of conditional liberty process. But if you are an adjudicated youth, the motion to revise and revoke and motion to stay of execution are the two legal options that you have for release. Now, Juvenile Court Standing Order 620 was issued on May 1st. It became effective on May the 4th. And this really extended the operations of the court under the exigent circumstances that were created by COVID-19. So I want to divide this section up into emergency matters, which were not significantly changed under this, as well as the extension that was made for some non-emergency virtual hearings. So in looking at the emergency matters, you see that under care and protection cases, 72-hour hearings are still happening on a virtual basis. Effectively, those 72-hour custody hearings are still happening within that statutorily mandated time frame, unless there is an agreement between the parties to continue those cases after June 1st, 2020. on delinquency and youthful offender matters, arraignments and dangerousness hearings are taking place virtually. And as it comes to detained young people, there's really three types of cases that are happening relative to motions for young people seeking release on their delinquency or youthful offender cases. Motions for reconsideration of bail. For young people who have had their bail revoked, they are able to come forth and seek release as release on that bail revocation. And lastly, young people who are detained awaiting a violation of probation hearing, they are still able to move forward. As to CRAs, child requiring assistance cases, for runaway petitions, those preliminary hearings are still being scheduled and held virtually. Additionally, the courts have to make every effort in these cases to provide the parent with the necessary application without requiring the parent to appear in court. And then once that application is completed, they are scheduling those matters. Now, as I stated before, in addition to those emergency matters, there has been an extension to non-emergency matters being heard under the standing order with the important caveat that you see on your screen. So where it's practical in view of skeletal court staffing, technological constraints, and the need to prioritize emergency matters. So effectively, in the discretion of the first justice in the particular county, these types of non-emergency hearings can now be heard. Typically, we're happy to see this extension happen, but given that caveat in resources in individual counties, we may end up seeing differences in the frequency of these cases being heard depending on the decisions made by the first justice. So when we look at care and protection matters, there is now an avenue for permanency hearings, court investigations, and guardian ad litem cases to now be heard. Under delinquency in youthful offender cases, the biggest change here, probable cause hearings and summons arraignments are going to be any of these hearings that are scheduled between March 16th and June the 1st will be continued to a date determined by the clerk magistrate. Tenders of plea, this is really one of the biggest additions here, where defense counsel and the prosecution can come to an agreement and a young person seeks to enter a tender of plea, which you're going to see because young people who are held and they feel that their case is stagnant, some of them are going to want to resolve their cases, particularly young people who are effectively doing dead time, sitting in detention where they're not getting education or any form of treatment. They're going to want to plea and resolve that case. It may be a plea to get out and go on probation. It may be a plea to just start their treatment under the custody and supervision of DYS. Now that is an option where as long as it, so both in agreed upon cases where the defense attorney and the prosecutor agree to the terms of the plea, and even in situations where there's an agreement to plea, but a difference as to what the ultimate adjudication will be, those can now be scheduled at the discretion of the first justice. As to CRAs, school-based CRAs like truancy cases, in general are continued until September 1st. Other CRAs where a child is in a temporary custody of DCF, again, may proceed at the discretion of the first justice. For guardianships and adoptions, these matters are being conducted administratively, and when a hearing is necessary, the courts are scheduling those as soon as is practicable, again, at the discretion of the first justice. And then lastly, where a motion for funds is necessary for investigations or other sorts of assessments, those are filed. And again, they're able to be conducted either administratively or virtually. So a few other considerations in light of these two most recent, standing orders. In delinquency matters, jury trials are still continued until September. So whether a young person is out in the community under conditions of release, whether they're still detained, those young people still face some uncertainty over how their cases will be resolved, because as of now, there's been no movement to, jury trials are unlikely to move forward before September. In care and protection matters, there will be an impact on reunification timelines and termination of parental rights under federal law. But CRAs, and this is something to really think about, schools are closed until the end of the academic year. So you have situations where these petitions have come forward because a young person was truant or facing some school-based issues. The school year was completely disrupted. You have young people who, even if they wanted to get back on track with school due to a lack of access to technology, a lack of access to quality internet, they haven't had an access to education. So even with these cases being continued into September, how do you evaluate a young person's educational performance when very clearly the access to education varies so much, sometimes between communities and sometimes even within communities? And then we're still trying to consider what are the pros and cons over this long-term use of virtual proceedings. Instead of young people being in court and standing there next to their lawyer while these hearings are happening, young people, these are now happening virtually. Attorney and client contact in the moment may not be available right now. Does that have an impact on the ability to effectively represent a young person? Does it have an impact or disparate impact perhaps on the results of these cases? Right now, we don't know, but that's something very important for us to watch and monitor moving forward. And then lastly, we have to look at, when courts will be reopening. So there's going to be upcoming guidance from the Supreme Judicial Court on reopening. Some of the options that have been talked about will be staggered scheduling, reconfiguring court buildings that will allow for social distancing, access to PPEs to keep people safe, and then on physical entry while maintaining public access. Now, with juvenile courts, we know that juvenile proceedings are not open to the public. So in the adult system, you have to navigate the fact that those are public proceedings and how to navigate social distancing in that context, whereas in a juvenile court, those are private. So as we begin to have ongoing discussions of reopening, these are some of the considerations we'll have to look at.
Thank you so much, Leon. So we're next going to be talking about probation. So some of this information, again, try to give you the numbers just to put everything in perspective. So that, as most people probably know, the numbers in probation for young people on probation is going to be much higher than those in DYS. Most young people who are adjudicated or on pretrial are supervised by probation. So as of March 2020, there are a little over 500 young people who are in community supervision, who are the risk needs category. 420 were administrative supervision, and 689 were on pretrial conditions of release. According to the commissioner, the conversation we're having with the commissioner, so not on the public tableau. This month, there were 37 young people who had violations of probation. On average, the past year and a half, it was more at averaging around 60 a month, and there was 150 young people on GPS monitoring. There's two asterisks on the community supervision and pretrial conditions. So for those on community supervision, more than half are on minimal supervision, and around 20% are considered high risk and having the highest level of supervision. This has been a trend based on work that probation has been doing for the past 2 or 3 years around changing the way they violate the violations of probation and using graduated responses and other administrative means to address violations rather than detention. The other number I wanted to highlight was this number of 689 young people who are held pretrial detention. This is significant. So when we're looking at the public tableau, which goes back to January 2017, unlike everything else which has been trending downward, the pretrial supervision of young people has actually been trending upwards. within that in that 3-year period, September 2018 was the lowest of number of young people who are in a pretrial supervision, and that has been steadily climbing to 689 out of March. Unsure why, but what some of the considerations are around all this idea of keeping people in the community, and is there fear by legal system actors that, well, if we're not going to detain them, we need to have someone's eye on them. There's also the Bragdon SJC case, which said people cannot be detained due to lack of financial ability, which came down end of 2017, so a year prior to September 2018. So there's just theories. It's unclear from our conversations from probation the reason of that, but we thought that was that's a significant trend that's in opposition to everything, all the other trends. Probation also oversees the care and protection and the CRA cases, so there's about 14,000 kids that they oversee. Their trends have also gone down with the drops in 51As, and they said that their trends are similar to what we're seeing normally in the summer months when schools are closed. Same thing for the CRAs, there are about 2,800 kids and the probation CRA caseload. And their typical trends are unsure how that's going to work, because the highest is in April and May, so these months, because it's the end of the school year and this is when most of the filings happen, and then it drops in the summer and then picks up again in the fall when school starts back up again. This is their typical trend. They're tracking to see what is going to happen as COVID continues. So one thing to mention, I've talked about some of the things that they have been doing. So pre-pandemic, this idea of graduated response. So again, a theme that we've seen even in prior calls, that agencies that have been instituting reforms of having a lighter touch or not such a heavy hand of the legal system have been more nimble in responding to COVID and not having to change entire culture. So that was one benefit, was having that the probation reforms from a few years ago and how it's helping young people today. The practices, they're not doing community visits, they're not doing home visits, they're not doing drug testing of young people. They're contacting young people and their collaterals, like, no, did this young person go to your support group? Yes, no, and that's it. And it's mostly by phone. They're not seeing truancy cases because of the school closures and the standing order, and saying that those are continued till September. Some of the things they're considering right now is, how do we transition to community, to the conditions if you're supposed to meet, have some kind of treatment program or do some program. Some of these programs have been able to transition smoothly into remote service delivery. Some have not. Some have just shut down. So they're trying to Probation Services is reassessing what those conditions are and the services and to make those accommodations. Work in progress. They mentioned that one of the biggest things that they've been hearing is young people like to hang out with each other, violating social distancing laws, and they're trying to figure out, well, how do you address that? Because they don't want that to be a violation for young people to be detained. But that's something that's on their forefront. Another piece is around sealing and expungement. Probation is in charge of sealing and expungement. The first two or three weeks of the pandemic with the state of emergency, there was no action on sealing and expungement, and we got clarification on why. With the court closures, but emergency matters moving, the courts had no staff, didn't have as much staff in the buildings, but then, a petition has to be filed or paperwork has to be moved. We need people to physically be in the court to be able to print out a paper or put it somewhere. So they redeployed the record staff to do that work for the first couple of weeks. But now that the court-based staff have been able to transition back between in court and remote, the record staff are back. So probation wants to know, sealing and expungement is still happening. And they've seen an actual increase in petitions because of the federal restrictions, the restrictions on COVID relief that are administered by the Small Business Administration. The SBA has basically said if you have a felony or any arrest for the past 10 years, if you've had a record, all sorts of things that are very, very restrictive, which if you're on our email list, we talked about and submitted comments about last week about those restrictions. So they've seen that has been something bringing the probation petitions to address that. In terms of Department of Children and Families, one of the things we have, you will not see any data slides here because the data, and I know that was one of the questions in the, for those who registered, like what are the numbers in DCF? We don't know those numbers. That information is not available. We hear that there is some data come in the process of being released. Is it being vetted right now? Some data will be able to be released. Minimal data, most data will not see the impact until a month and a half after the decisions have been made. So the one data that is circulating is the drop in 51As. According to Commissioner Spears, that drop is similar to the rate of the reporting rate of summer break. She said the drop is mostly from 51As filed by schools. All other, like, there has been no other drop from other mandated reporters. In terms of the services of DCF, there has been guidance around visitation and how to do it, but there has been a significant drop in parents and visitation with parents and with siblings, including some area offices just not doing it at all and some foster families not doing it and not allowing it. Some issues around technology access, and everything is going, telehealth is moving remote, visitation is moving remote. Some schools are giving a Chromebooks to their students, but the OCA is convening a work group for those to try to figure out, where the funding sources, who's able to provide them, so that they can identify young people in state custody who could be prioritized for the state to be providing them technology to be able to continue to connect to the outside world. Finally, there is no moratorium on case closures. This has been a national ask around young people who are transitioning out. What they said, DCF offered some guidance this morning around transitioning youth and case closures. Their guidance, the area offices are asked to slow down case closures. So what they said is there is no moratorium, but the number of cases has gone down 5% compared to the similar time last year. One of the things they said is, they're trying to put administrative hurdles to case closures rather than saying, no, don't close cases for young people. So things like, if you are going to close a case for a young person, go to a supervisor to make sure that that's appropriate. And if the supervisor says yes, the young person has the option to use the fair hearing process as a burden as a young person to use the fair hearing process to slow down that case closure. One other question we've been having was around this emergency placement. So in middle of April, the governor signed an executive order giving EEC flexibility to expedite the licensing of temporary emergency placements for those who have to isolate or quarantine due to COVID. For those that are available to DCS, there are four programs in the state that are available for kids in DCF congregate care, so not kids in foster care, and not any kid in the community. If those in the foster in congregate care, because of those are young people in close proximity where it could be you don't want a congregate care program to be a hot spot. So there are four programs who are up and running, and our understanding is they have the capacity to serve 21 youth. Most of those would serve, any youth. They can get a referral from any youth in a congregate care provider, except GRI. It's a very large program. So the priority is for GRI kids in any of the GRI services to have the preference for these COVID positive youth units. As I mentioned multiple times, it's for kids in congregate care. There are other kids that may need quarantine or isolation. So DCF is seeking sites, physical sites, as well as programs to manage, to be able to have these units for young people who need to quarantine, for those who are in foster care, and anybody who's not in congregate care, if they tested positive or need quarantine. So some of the considerations, and there's a coalition that Mass Law Reform and the Children's Law Center in Massachusetts are leading, and Jessica Berry presented on this last call. Where they're doing some advocacy around young people with the DCF and the DCF caseload. So one priority is around young people who are in the transition age youth and the fear about them being homelessness. So there, thing is around young people as they age out at the age of 18 and what happens to them, as well as those who reach the age of 22 and then they age out during the pandemic with no support. So there's this worry about them being homeless. So being able to keep, you know, sign on, remain on the voluntary caseload, but also not to be dropped because of they're not able to make meet work and education requirements. Federal law provides flexibility. It's up to the state to say what are the requirements to remain eligible. The one other, so that, there is some flexibility that, and one of the things that's a barrier is around funding for housing. So there's a lot of services, but not fund housing. And that's one of the biggest concerns of young people. And another area where for transitioning youth, so even those who have not aged out, but those are like, you know, 16 or 17, where they're losing placements because they are violating social distancing. You know, they're hanging out with their friends and then they're not able to come home because, you know, the placement where they're at has someone who is medically vulnerable and they, you know, they cannot be quarantined in a private home. So what do you do with those? I mentioned earlier the drop in parent child and sibling visitation. Oh, sorry, this is a repeat. So ignore the last section. Again, so there is an executive order. Sorry, there is a proposal for an executive order on behalf of transition age youth that this coalition I mentioned earlier sent to the governor and many key stakeholders, asking that there's a moratorium on discharging young transition age youth from this voluntary extended care retroactive to March 10th, and suspending any requirements to participate in, you know, education and programming during the pandemic. Also asking that if a young person says, I'm 18, I'm done, I never want to see DCF ever again in my life, but then they're like, no, I actually do need those voluntary services to expedite them being able to roll back in, and to look at, and one of the key barriers is, again, funding to provide these services and to provide housing, if we can look for ways to prioritize that in the budget ask. And that is a lot. And what I'm wanting to invite right now, four members representing the Committee for Public Council Services. CPCS is a state agency, but this perspective is, you know, these are all attorneys who work with young people who are directly impacted by those policies. So I want to introduce, sorry, Ziad, I put the wrong title for you. So Ziad is leads CPCS's Youth Advocacy Division. COVID-19 Task Force, Chris and Deb Freitas represent the CAFLD, the Child Welfare COVID-19 Response, and then Aaron O'Sullivan, who comes in from the EdLaw Project. So if you want to unmute yourselves and tell us, give us your response and thoughts.
I can go first. I'm not really sure. We kind of just, I don't know if we settled on an order, but I'm happy to step back. Okay, I'll go ahead. This is Ziad Hopkins. Thank you all for joining. So that was a great overview, and Leon did a great job explaining the legal framework of, you know, how the court is accessible. So I don't want to get into the weeds on the legal stuff. I want to talk about three general topics and then make comments about each one of them. One is access to court. The second is the data. And the third is talking about community resources. And I sort of pose these all as queries to this group of people on CFJJ who care about young people to sort of start thinking about advocacy. I shouldn't say start, but just put it on the radar screen. So in terms of access to courts, I think we've all been trying to figure out where the ground is underneath our feet with COVID-19. I'm not sure we've totally found it, but I think there are two legal concepts that are important that are impacting how we do this work right now. One is tolling, and the second is this idea of what's a critical stage. And again, without getting into the weeds, tolling, the SJC seems to say that essentially all the time standards or a variety of time standards that are associated with moving cases through the courts are paused or stopped, and we don't know when they're going to start up again. And there's different standards for different procedures in different situations, whether for trial, for 58A hearings, statute of limitations, filings of this, filings of that. And so that concept is really going to be, it's going to be a mess. And there is a case in the SJC already pending on one aspect of tolling, but that sort of concept of how does COVID-19 impact deadlines and timelines is really going to be an issue, and it's going to play out in as well. And the second one is this legal concept of what's a critical stage. So when does a young person have to traditionally be quote unquote in court and entitled to be present when their case is being heard? And this is true for all defendants, whether they're adults or juveniles. And so the question is, how is the new procedure going to impact and interact and with the constitutional requirements around critical stage hearings? So those would be essentially things where you have witnesses under testimony. So I don't know, I don't think I'm on video, but just imagine someone, for example, testifying on video, what it looks like, what you can and can't see. Even if someone's in court, what is it going to look like if they've got a face mask on and you're trying to evaluate their credibility about something? So there's all sorts of issues around that. But I think just keep those two legal issues in mind, tolling and this and the issues around what's a critical stage and what comports with constitutional requirements in each critical stage. I also think that as Leon mentioned, sort of what is it going to look like coming out of COVID-19? There is an opportunity to reimagine what court can look like for courts and for families in their youth and youth. I think, you know, when we sort of stop and think back, we've shoehorned youth into adult-like courts, and maybe that's just not the best way that it should be set up physically. Like, for the first time, we can look at the physical layout of a court and say, well, does this even, did the old system, quote unquote, even meet the needs of young people and their families? And maybe this is a time to sort of really think about that. There's a little bit of an opening. Then the second one is on data. Sana did a great job presenting the data. You know, I think I always want more because I'm a defense attorney, but pretrial detentions, even with incoming arrests, are down about 35%. Right? So that's huge. Of course, then it begs the question, why did we ever need this in the first place? Why did it take a pandemic to suggest that we could reduce pretrial detentions this much, if not even more? So I would love to see that continue even post-pandemic. And then the last point I want to make is just on community resources. It seems like the bottleneck for many of our young people who are in detention, either pretrial detention or I should say in commitment, is the lack of resources in the community. And we all know that there was always a lack of resources for the youth in DYS, either pretrial or commitment beforehand. And COVID, like with many things, has shined a spotlight on inequities. And this is one of them, is the lack of resources in the community. And sort of what does a COVID-19 quote unquote release plan look like for communities where even in the best of times, they might not have the resources to support themselves. And now they're even further behind the eight ball in that regard. So I think we really need to be thinking about how can we support those successful community programs and partners who have always supported our young people, how they can be expanded and how we can get more of them. And I'm particularly concerned about how they're supported in them creating their COVID-19 safe reentry plans and making sure that they have as much support from the government, from the governor and from others as the restaurants and the businesses are getting to reopen. And I'll leave it at that.
Deb and Chris, do you guys want to go next?
Yes, yeah, sure. Hi, so I am Chris Freitas, and this is Deb Freitas. We are a private firm that contracts with CPCS to do the camera protection, child requiring assistance, delinquency, and youthful offender cases. It is the bulk of our practice, and we also are on the CPCS CAFL COVID response team. So our hope today is to share with you our experiences and on-the-ground observations and those of our colleagues doing this work. We are going to focus our comments, like Ziad, on three issues. The first is data, the second is services, including placement and visitation, and the third is kids aging out or harm reduction for young adults and a looking forward perspective. So first, I think that the parents, families, and attorneys that we work with are most frustrated that 2 months have gone by since the governor declared the state of emergency due to COVID in Massachusetts, and DCF remains one of the only congregate care providers in the state to not release any public data regarding COVID status. Also, experientially, we are hearing that DCF social workers in multiple counties, including Worcester, Essex, Middlesex, and Suffolk, are reporting to judges that DCF has no placements, both for CRA kids and delinquency kids in DCF custody. DCF social workers are also reporting that the new emergency residential programs, which the governor created for isolation, quarantine, and COVID positive kids, are just for COVID positive kids, which leaves those facilities not fully occupied. Through a public records request to EEC, we learned that as of April 29, there were 9 programs which applied for emergency residential status. Of those 9 programs, 4 are open to new intakes, while the other 5 are only serving their existing child residents. Those programs propose everything from separate units at the same facility to off-campus units and renting of local apartments. Some of the programs in their application limited their intakes to COVID-positive youth only, although many did not have that limitation expressed in their application to the EEC. And so as of April 29, the emergency residential programs were located in Walpole, Mansfield, Canton, Framingham, Attleboro, Housatonic, East Hampton, Southborough, and Salem. And Mary, I saw that you had a comment about what they are. They were created by a governor's executive order, I believe it was on April 16th, that allowed EEC to create these new emergency residential programs. And then the EEC later issued at least 2 specific guidances to these programs for what their operation and field manuals should look like. And if you like, we can provide those links to Senna later, and she can share those as well. Additionally, DCF is almost uniformly not providing in-person contact to parents and kids seeking visitation. Instead, it's relying on virtual contact exclusively, which is not always a good fit for young kids, kids with developmental delays, parents with disabilities, or even adolescents. And so families remain disappointed in that regard as well. I think Senna mentioned previously DCF did issue guidance yesterday regarding young adult services who may be aging out. There are 2 key points that we just want to review from that guidance. The first is that they did not explicitly and uniformly extend services to young adults aging out. Instead, it focuses on being flexible under the circumstances, and it may mean planning a transition for later to a later date. And then secondly, and happily, DCF did incorporate the federal guidance on relaxing the work and education requirements for this population, and noting that case closings as a result of not working or not going to school should not be happening. And then finally, looking forward, you know, Family First, the federal legislation that is already begun in several places across the country, does put an emphasis on family stabilization and removal prevention. And we think that this is a great opportunity for Massachusetts, although it has deferred implementation until 2021, to begin looking towards implementing those services in advance of 2021, given all the struggles that families and children are having. And then I think we're learning that a safe place to keep kids is at home with services.
Thank you, Chris and Deb. Erin, are you able to join now?
Sure. Yeah, I can join. Hi, everyone. So I'm Erin O'Sullivan. I'm one of the senior counsel at the EdLaw Project. If you don't know what EdLaw is, we are an initiative of CBCS and the Youth Advocacy Foundation. And we our job is to support all the court-appointed attorneys across the state that represent kids. So we do training, direct casework, advisory, et cetera. So I'm just going to quickly go over education and what we've been seeing in both DYS and in congregate care. So I will say DYS has been open with us about what is going on. So that's great that we've had some discussions with them. So what should be happening right now is that kids should be getting access to remote learning, and that should be either virtual learning or with other materials provided. And this should include both resources and lessons. So it's not just supposed to be, you know, giving kids some packets and things like that. It's also supposed to be some lessons and direct interaction from teachers. Kids should also be getting IEP services now. And by now, everyone should have their remote learning plan or another written plan that details what IEP services they will be getting during this time. Lastly, kids should be getting communication from their teachers. So for kids who are in DYS, they should be having communication with the teachers from the collaborative that provides education services there. If kids are on an IEP for reading or math, they should also be getting communication from the SEIS, the Special Education and Institutional Settings instructors that provide that special ed support. And if they have other needs on their IEP, then they should also be hearing from their homeschool district that should be providing those additional services and support. Some issues that we're seeing, I know DYS have been working on internet issues and has gotten internet up and running, and I believe all but two of their facilities, and every facility except for, I believe, those two units are using Google Classroom, and the other two units are using paper packets. So Google Classroom, if you don't know what that is a portal that is used to access assignments and work. It is not like a virtual classroom where, you know, they can sign in and have a lesson from a teacher. It's kind of this central place where they can go in and get assignments. And there's like a chat feature with teachers, et cetera. Did people hear me? I think my microphone was
something. You're back on.
Okay. Where did you last hear me?
We didn't lose you much.
Oh, good. Okay. So, so there's not any live streaming or video instruction happening right now for kids in DYS. So in public school districts, schools are either doing recorded lessons or live streaming. That is not happening right now for kids in DYS. Teachers are available to talk with kids in the chat function through Google Classroom, but that is something the youth has to initiate. And they have both the general education and special education teachers available in the Google Classroom. So just to clarify, the collaborative staff that provide the education services to kids in DYS are not physically going into the facility. They are, you know, following the governor's order to close schools and believe that applies to them. So they are not physically going in to a facility. DYS is also making sure that they're working with districts to make sure that kids will get credit for the work that they're doing right now. And lastly, DYS is not getting support from home districts. All the curriculum decisions are being made by the collaborative. So, they're working with them in SEIS, but one piece of advice we have is that for kids on IEPs, you should really be including that home district. They are still responsible for children while they're in DYS, and they should be involved in meetings and coming up with the remote learning plan for IEP services, et cetera. So that is one piece of advice, and we would advise people, you know, schedule a virtual or phone IEP meeting if there are some issues to discuss with everyone to make sure this child is getting what they need. There is a concern with equity and access here because a lot of families do not have the ability to do a video conference or even a phone call to be able to do for that amount of time. So it's something that has to be an ongoing discussion of what works for the family and what support they would need to be able to engage in a meeting like that. So for services beyond English and math on the IEP, again, make sure that home district is involved. That's not really happening right now, but this was a concern that we had before COVID as well. And lastly, just keep track of what a child is or is not getting, especially if they have an IEP. That's going to be important when things do reopen. And if you have some concerns, always contact the education coordinator on the unit to see what a kid is getting and talk about concerns. So for kids in congregate care, we have been part of that coalition that Sana mentioned earlier that has been working with the department on these issues. And we're hoping to get something to the commissioner soon outlining some of our concerns. So what should be happening right now is for those kids in congregate care, again, should be getting the remote education, including lessons and IEP services. And they should be receiving a remote learning plan or other written plan. And also they should be having regular communication from their school. They should be hearing from teachers and staff on an individual basis. So this shouldn't just be district-wide communication. They should be individually reaching out to that student. Some issues that we're seeing are access to the internet and devices. You know, whether the facility has internet, whether they have a device for a child to use, whether they need to get one from the school, or, you know, whether that district is providing a device for a student. So sadly, it's another equity and access issue here where, you know, some kids just are not getting the access that they need based on what school district they have or what facility they're in, et cetera. And there's some other program issues, you know, with internet and devices. Sometimes programs have policies that you can't have outside devices come in, or, you know, they have an internet policy. And so trying to work around those to make sure that it's not impeding a student's ability to get like a Chromebook from school and use the internet to access their remote learning. There's also issue with staff capacity to be able to provide support for those kids who need it. So a student may have remote learning, a plan and everything set up, but a lot of kids need someone to be there to support them and help them get started. And I know that staff capacity is a big issue for that. Some programs have also raised privacy concerns with students participating in virtual lessons on Zoom and other things. So again, another issue that we're trying to work on. And a lot of communication difficulties for a lot of these kids. You know, there has to be communication between a lot of different people, including DCF, the school district, the facility where they're at, and possibly the school. If they're, you know, at a private, a special ed school, then that's another person to bring in. And so how do you make sure that all that communication is happening? And they may also have a separate educational decision maker. So a lot of different players that have to be in communication for things to work. So our advice here is, you know, can work with the home school district. If there are technology issues, we've been able to resolve some by getting Chromebooks. And I know some districts have even provided some hotspots for internet. So work with them on those issues. Work with the DCF social worker and the DCF ed liaison to try to resolve those facility policy issues that I was talking about. Schedule a virtual phone or IEP meeting if you can to try to sort everything out. It's a way to kind of force the communication between all those parties and keep track of what a student is getting and not getting, especially with kids on an IEP. And lastly, if there are any issues and you think that you're working with a student that may need legal assistance, getting access to their educational services, please feel free to call Ed Law for some help, and I'll put the information in the chat. Thanks.
Thank you, Ziad, Chris, Deb, and Aaron. I promised a question break, but we're running out of time, and I want to make sure we have time for our next speaker. So keep questions in the chat. We're going to keep them at the end. But I just want to do like a quick 30-second update on state advocacy efforts. There's three pieces of legislation I want to make sure you guys are still aware are still happening and need to move in the pandemic. First one is raise the age, House 3420. In the PowerPoint that I will send you, you'll have an analysis of how the different age, the juvenile and adult systems are responding to COVID and why it's a case for raising the age. This bill is in the Judiciary Committee. It's supposed to report out by July 31st, so any calls or emails to the committee would be appreciated to get a favorable response. The decarceration legislation we talked about last time, that is currently also in the Judiciary Committee, has a June 30th recommendation deadline. We're hoping that we can get support for that legislation as well. And finally, Governor Baykeld filed a bill, House 66, which would actually reverse a lot of these reforms and increase prosecutors' power and authority to hold defendants pre-trial by expanding the dangerousness statute and removing some of the due process protections. That is in judiciary. The deadline to report is July 31st. We're actually hoping to get calls to oppose that legislation. And then we want to make sure we have the discussion about some of the federal lawsuits. There is a federal lawsuit. So around people who are held in detention and looking at similar public health responses to release a lot of those people to make sure that detention centers are not hotspots. So March 27th, Lawyers for Civil Rights filed a lawsuit against Bristol County Sheriff Hodgson. And we just want to introduce Oren Nimney from Lawyers Committee, who is the lead attorney on this case, to talk about the case, the ruling, and what are the consequence, like what's happening with that lawsuit and the results.
Sure. Thanks so much for having me. I really appreciate it. And it's been good to listen to all of the wonderful information that everyone's been able to share so far. So like Sana was saying, we filed litigation against Bristol County, largely because, you know, people in immigration detention facilities, which is, you know, civil immigration custody, across Massachusetts and across the country, are living in congregate facilities where there's an inability to social distance. The sanitary conditions and hygienic conditions are bad across the board, but are particularly bad inside of Bristol County House of Corrections. And Bristol County has multiple parts to it. There's a pretrial and sentenced wing that relates to criminal detention, and then there's an immigration detention wing because the sheriff of that county has contracted with the Department of Homeland Security to allow part of the facility to engage in immigration detention. And so it's one of the few facilities in Massachusetts that does immigration detention, along with Plymouth and Franklin counties as well. And so there's been some litigation, there's been a class action brought in Plymouth County now, both in the criminal detention wing and in the immigration detention wing. And then there's been some individual actions to release people who are particularly vulnerable or have comorbidities with COVID-19 in Franklin County. But for Bristol County, we filed a class action not on behalf of people that are particularly vulnerable, but on behalf of everyone in ICE detention in Bristol County, basically saying that the inability to social distance had turned what is supposed to be non-punitive detention, which is, you know, a little bit of a legal fiction about how civil detention is supposed to only be for, you know, processing time between a civil immigration infraction and removal, that it had turned that type of detention from non-punitive into punitive detention and was putting everyone's lives at risk. So we filed that class action at the end of March. It's in front of Judge Young in the federal court here in Massachusetts. Judge Young embarked on a process of individually evaluating everyone in detention based on their criminal history, their immigration history, their medical status, and their biographical information, and also a release plan as to where they would be housed and what conditions they would be housed if they were to be released. After going through that bail review process, Judge Young has, about 50 people have been ordered released as part of this case. And so the population of Bristol County was 148, at the beginning of the lawsuit and has now been reduced down to about 80 through these releases and then also through some transfers and releases on other bond or bail matters that were separate from the litigation. Recently, we won a preliminary injunction, which is an order from the court that Bristol County Sheriff's Office has to stop doing certain activities. And that injunction is important beyond the releases themselves, which are important because people get to go back and be with their families, do caretaking for their children, and actually be home in a safer environment. The preliminary injunction added on top of those releases some additional conditions. One is that Bristol County can no longer admit anyone new. That means no one else can be admitted into Bristol County, either from their criminal wing or from the outside. The second condition was that Bristol County has to engage in universal testing, not only of people who are in detention, but also of staff and correctional officers in the facility, of which there's been about 20 people among staff and correctional officers that have tested positive, and then one person in immigration detention and a number of people in the criminal wing that have tested positive for COVID-19. And then recently, Judge Young also amended his order to say that people could not be transferred out of Bristol County without being tested and testing negative, or refusing to be tested and then being quarantined for 14 days. And so this includes people that are slated for removal. I saw a question as to whether or not people are being denied release or bail if they don't have release plans or places that they can go. It was Judge Young's indication that that might be one of the factors, but luckily we were able to find placements either with family or with community groups or religious service groups for everyone in the facility. So those that have not been released, it's somewhat unclear for everyone why they were denied, but most people seem to have been denied based on a combination of other factors. That said, there are still 60 people's applications for bail sitting in front of Judge Young waiting to be reviewed. So it's possible that more people will be released from that facility after this slate of testing that Judge Young has ordered has happened. One note on the testing and why it's important. The allegations from the beginning were that many people might be exposed to coronavirus, and the response from Bristol County was always that they had no positive cases. That was a bold claim because until recently, until the beginning of May, no one in detention had been tested. We don't know what the protocol that the government is going to use for testing is or how many people have been tested yet, but the government has been ordered to produce both a protocol, what tests that they are using, how many people have been tested, what the results are by May 28th. So we should be getting that information somewhat soon. And then from there, Judge Young may decide to release more people or may make other adjustments to the sanitary conditions inside the facility. The other thing that the judge is still looking at and was one of the bases for this order was the lack of contact tracing. So there have been a number of guards and nursing staff that have tested positive for COVID-19, but there's been almost no contact tracing between them and the detainees or other people that they've interacted with. All of that's to say, the case is going fairly well. It is somewhat unique in the country, sadly, in that there have been some releases from ICE detention facilities across the country in smaller batches of people based on comorbidities and other health conditions. But sadly, other facilities and other courts have not really followed this model so far. And this applies doubly to people in criminal detention. The two caveats are there's a case out in Northern California and a case in New Hampshire that are following a similar process of individualized bail review and releases so that people can go back to their families, be with them while the larger case is being adjudicated about what the conditions actually are on the ground and what, you know, further relief would look like for the people that are inside and for reforming the facilities themselves.
Thank you so much, Oren. And I know we have a few minutes left, so I apologize for everybody else who I promised to have a Q&A. I was going to give an update around what was happening with the SJC case. There is a secondary case right now filed by Prison Legal Services around the issue of sentenced individuals and the Baker administration not releasing folks. So that case is currently pending. But I just want to open the last few minutes for questions. And I know many of you have been using the chat, so I appreciate that and responding in chat. But I also want to give a chance to folks on the phone who are not have access to the chat if there's any questions or comments in the last few minutes. Okay, that was great. And 2 minutes to spare, I was worried. First thing, I want to thank all of our speakers today. Leon, thank you. Mary, thank you. Ziad, Chris, Deb, Aaron, Oren, thank you all so much. You have brought so much, bringing this information of all individuals of all ages who are in some kind of government custody. And what their impact is. And it's great to know that all of you are advocates on behalf of all the young people in Massachusetts. I want to thank you all, just as a term in terms of follow-up. Like I mentioned earlier, this information, the recording, and this PowerPoint will be on our website. I will also be gradually emailing it to everybody who submitted who registered online and sent me an email. If I have your email for this presentation, I will email it to you. If you joined without RSVPing, just email me and I'll send it to you as well. Make sure to, if you can subscribe to our newsletter, that's the best way to make sure you do not lose anything. So cfjj.org/jj-news. We will make sure everything goes up there as well. So I want to thank you all so much. And I really appreciate all of you and all the work that you're doing. And see you soon, and hopefully with our next call.